Shalom, I'm Ryan White, and I'd like to invite you to join me on the Joshua Generation Show on Hebraic Roots Network. Help us spread the Word of God to all the nations. You can check us out on the schedule at HebraicRootsNetwork.com to see when our episodes are airing, or you can check us out on demand anytime on the web at HebraicRootsNetwork.com, or on your Roku device on your television, you can check us out as well on demand anytime from the comfort of your own living room. I hope to see you there. I'm Ryan White of Rooted in Torah Ministries, and today we're going to be discussing Yeshua, our Patron, as part of the series on the Gospel of the Suffering Servant. Now, this is a very interesting teaching that has been interesting for me to study, because there's so much culture in the New Testament that we just fail to completely understand when we haven't been exposed to a lot of the cultural terms and the parts of the culture that was well known in the New Testament world, right? And a lot of times we read things and we don't necessarily understand them from the perspective that they would have been understood in the first century. Now remember, the Bible was written for us, but it was not written to us. You can't write a book that is written to every single generation. There's simply no possible way, because the terminology changes, idioms change, the languages change. I mean, we're reading in our English, and even if you were going back and looked at a 1611 King James English Bible, that is very difficult to read, because the language in just 400 years has changed so much that it makes it almost impossible for someone to just look at that original language, or at least the King James language, and even read it today. How much more Greek that was from 2,000 years ago, or Hebrew that was from even farther before that? So it really helps us to study the languages, but realize, even if you're studying Hebrew, that there's a lot of things in the Hebrew that were cultural things that we just don't have in our world today. We discussed this with the concept of honor and shame, with justice and righteousness. And there's just a plethora of different things in the languages that are in our scriptures that we have to go back and understand them from our culture, from their cultural perspective. So how can we do that? Well, we have archaeology, and that's really why there's been so much opening up of the scriptures in the last 100 years or so, is because we've finally been able, with the discovery of the Rosetta Stone that was back in the 1800s, the Rosetta Stone was basically an interlinear inscription that was in, I don't remember the exact languages, but one of the languages was Greek, and then it had some in some of the other ancient languages, right? And using the Rosetta Stone and other interlinear sort of tablets, they've been able to open up the languages of the ancient Near East. And so now all these artifacts that they've been digging up, they're actually able to translate them and see what they mean, and actually be able to catch a glimpse of the culture. And suddenly when they do this, they see these things in scripture, and suddenly things start to make a lot more sense. It opens up our eyes, because some of these things, it's kind of assumed. Think about this. If I was to tell you that I got on an airplane and I flew to Jacksonville, Florida, you would understand completely what I meant. You would understand that I would have had to take time off of work. I would have had to get in my, I would have purchased a ticket. I would have had to get a ride to the airport or driven myself. The people would have had to have jet fuel in the airplane. And all of these things are automatically understood as soon as I said that I flew down to Jacksonville, Florida. Just think about the scriptures. How many times something is written there, but it's not fully explained? Why is that? Because the people already understood the concepts that were throughout that language in that time. There was no need to explain. Remember, they had a limited commodity of paper. They couldn't just go to the store and purchase 500 sheets for $5. It was very expensive to use paper, and so they used it sparingly. And not only that, a lot of people didn't even have access to paper. I mean, it wasn't like you go to your church building and there's a Bible in the back of every pew. A lot of the synagogues were fortunate just to have a complete set of the scriptures, especially out in the diaspora. As you get further out, these things were not that common and available, and so they were a very oral culture, right? They passed things along orally. They memorized scripture. The teachings of Yeshua were not even written down until at least 20 years after his death. Why is that? Because they were being passed on orally. To them, that was a more secure means of passing them on, and a better means because paper was such a limited commodity. So they would pass on the stories orally, and they did a very good job at preserving the stories in that manner. So with that in mind, what is one of the things that you hear a lot of the time about Yeshua and about scriptures? How many of you have heard the phrase, "It's all about relationship"? Yes, it is all about relationship, but we have to ask ourselves, was there a protocol for relationships back in the first century? And I would propose to you, the answer is yes. There was a very distinct protocol for relationships in the first century. Okay, and it behooves us to go in and study these relationships and the culture associated with this and the protocols associated with this. And so that's what we're going to be discussing today, is the protocol of the relationships that existed in the first century. And that was what was called patron-client relationships. You might also hear it called benefaction or patronage or any of these terms that are associated with it. But the big thing is that within the relationships, there was a patron and there was a client, okay? The patron was generally of a higher hierarchical status in society, right? This was someone who was a benefactor. They were able to provide something that the client could not provide for themselves, whether that is money, whether that's access to goods, right? If you were a business owner, you had to have patrons. What we would call a supplier today in that day and age was called a patron. They provided you access to goods. And so there was a very intense protocol for this that was well understood. And so it helps us to have gone into extra biblical writings, into the writings of Greek philosophers even, just to understand the protocol that was in these days. And you'll be able to see this in scripture. It's just a matter of actually understanding what they understood in that day. They didn't need to write this protocol in scripture because everyone understood what a patron was, how a patron was supposed to act, and what a client was, and how a client was supposed to react. And once we understand the protocol based on other writings outside of scripture, then we can go in and we can see this protocol in place. So that's what we're going to do. So the first thing is the client, or the patron, right? The patron is this person who has something that the client needs. And so this could be, like I said, money, goods. This could even be access to a city. If you were coming into a city and you wanted to become a citizen of that city, you had to have a patron sponsor you into that city. It gained you access to the city. Gods were thought of as patrons, and their worshipers were the clients. Everything within their world revolved around this understanding of patron-client relationships. And it was even there in the Hebrew, with the Jews. We're going to see some examples of that. That this was not something that was isolated just to the Greco-Roman world, that this was part of the Jewish culture of that day. And when we see these things, we're going to see some really interesting things. Okay? So the patron has something that the client needs. So how does this relationship start? The client has to petition the patron. The patron doesn't go seek out the client per se. The client has to somehow petition the patron. And as we saw in the last series on justice and righteousness, how does he petition him? Well, one of the big things we see in scriptures is Israel cries out to God. Remember, when they were in Egypt and they were slaves, what did they do? They cried out to God, and he responded. That initiated a relationship. We saw that at the Red Sea. We saw that every single time in Judges, in the book of Judges, the people go astray. They go after other gods, and then things start to happen bad to them. And so what do they do? God doesn't just come down and rescue them. He waits until they cry out. And that initiates that patron-client relationship. He comes down and judges between the two of them and establishes a judge. So as the patron, or as the clients, they're crying out to him, and his response is to establish a judge in that day who can save them from their oppressors. Another thing that you see throughout Scripture, what does it say? Just multiple verses. You can find this all over the place. It always says, all who call upon the name of Yahweh will be saved. What is it talking about there? Is it saying that we have to pronounce his name correctly? Is it only if we say Yahweh, however the correct way is, that we'll be saved? No, this is playing on the understanding of patron-client relationships. We have to call out to him. We have to initiate the request for a relationship. So all who call out on the name or the authority or the honor of Yahweh will be saved. Why? Because we are the clients. We call out. He becomes our patron and initiates a relationship. Okay? But we need to understand how the relationship works. Because, it's not really good biblical theology to say that everyone who just says, God save me, is going to be saved. There are verses that seem to indicate that, but if you look at Scripture as a whole, you can be in the saved camp and be kicked out. Just like in the wilderness, people were saved, right? And actually, if you look at the Hebrew wording there, look at the wording when they go over and they're crossing over the Red Sea, or the Sea of Reeds. Moses says, see and look, here is your salvation. They were saved when they went through the Red Sea, but then they got to Mount Sinai, then they got the Torah, then they went through the wilderness, and how many of them made it? Two, right? Joshua and Caleb, and of course the younger ones, and the younger generation made it, but just because you got into the camp, that's your salvation, doesn't mean that you can't be thrown out of the camp if you go into open rebellion. And that's all played out here in this understanding of patron and client relationships, because once again, it's all about the relationship and the maintenance of the relationship. Remember, willful open rebellion is a breaking down of the relationship. There's an example that I always use with understanding sins that involves my children. There's three main types of sin, okay? There is completely ignorant sin. It's oftentimes, you'll see the Hebrew word is shagag or shagaga. This is a sin of complete and utter ignorance. You'll also see the sins that are called avon, oftentimes, which are sins that require a penalty with them. The Hebrew word chata or sin is really kind of just a generic term that covers all types of sins. It doesn't really specify which type of sin there is. And then the last word that's really important is the term pesha. Pesha. And that is willful, open, high-handed rebellion. That's in your face, God. Okay, so here's the example of how to understand these three different types, three main types of sin. Okay, let's say that my wife makes me a batch of cookies, and they're my favorite cookies because she puts some coffee grounds in them, and they're just amazing the way that she makes them. Okay, so she makes this batch specially for me, and I put them in a cookie jar because I like to have my cookies cooled down. I don't like them when they're hot. Okay. And so they're in the cookie jar, and I just had my fourth son, but he's not old enough to even get to the cookies yet. So we'll just discuss my other three sons. My youngest son, he comes up and without even knowing that anything's wrong, he grabs a cookie out of the cookie jar and starts eating it. And I see him, I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Gabriel, those are not your cookies. You cannot eat those cookies. You have committed a sin against me, because that's what a sin is. Sin is basically an offense against another party. You can see it used even in secular usage in the book of Genesis, where Abraham sinned against one of the kings. I can't remember who it was that uses that term, but basically my son there, he committed an offense against me. But did he know that it was wrong what he did? No, he didn't. But there, it still meant, it doesn't mean just because you don't know that it's wrong doesn't mean that it's not a sin, right? Just because you didn't know that you weren't supposed to steal or you didn't know that you were supposed to keep the Shabbat doesn't mean it's not a sin still, but we got to understand it in terms of the relationship, okay? So because, you know, my youngest son, Gabriel, because I knew that he didn't know, he was in complete ignorance, I say, okay, you know, I forgive you. It's okay. It's okay, son. But now I gather all my sons together and I go, look, guys, these are my cookies. Mommy made them specially for me. I don't want any of you to touch them. Not that I would really do this. I would always share my cookies with my sons, but for this scenario. And so they go, okay, okay, Daddy. So now he knows, right? Now he's aware that is a sin. And if you actually look at the so-called sin sacrifice, we'll talk about later on the better translation for that. But if you look at the instructions in Leviticus 4, Leviticus 5, and Leviticus 6 with these sacrifices that are for sins that were committed, they use this term shagaga, and you can see that the person is completely unaware in certain circumstances that what he did was wrong. How many times have you done something and then later on went to the scriptures and gone, oh, wait a minute, I didn't know that was wrong. Or, you know, maybe you were doing something and then later on during the day, you're sitting there kind of reflecting on what you did and go, oh, you know what, I really offended this person and I didn't even mean to, right? Just because you weren't aware that you offended someone doesn't mean that you still don't need to go back and make that relationship right. That's the basis for the sacrifices in Leviticus. Okay, so that was my first son. So now they're all aware that it is a sin to eat my cookies. Okay, so now my middle son, Xander, he loves cookies and he's just sitting there staring at that jar and staring at it and all day, and finally he just can't help himself. And he grabs the cookie out of there, puts the lid back on, and runs over the corner and eats it really fast. Okay? Now, my oldest son, and my oldest son is really sweet, he would never do this, but let's just pretend that my oldest son had hit his teenage years and is now a rebellious son, and he sees the cookies and he looks at me and he goes, you know, I don't even care. I'm going to eat those cookies. So he grabs that cookie and he walks over right in front of me and just starts eating it slowly right in front of my face. Oh, this is so good, right? What's the difference between my middle son, Xander, who went and hid in a corner and ate his cookie, and the one who walked over and ate it right in front of me? Relationship. It's all about relationship. My middle son, Xander, there, he went and hid in the corner to do it. Why? Because he was ashamed of what he was doing. He was overcome by the flesh, essentially. And he went and he hid because he was embarrassed. He didn't want me to know because that would hurt the relationship between us. Now, my oldest son in this scenario, he would no longer cared about the relationship. He was, in fact, trying to spite me by eating it in front of me. And that is exactly how the Bible discusses sins that can be forgiven versus sins that require either karat, cutting off, or death. When someone does something, God knows that we're human. We are going to mess up. And that doesn't make it okay, but that doesn't destroy the relationship. Okay, there can still be reconciliation between the two of us as long as he makes amends for what he's done wrong. My other son, though, he's in open rebellion. He no longer wants a, a relationship. Whenever you see in the Torah things like, you know, the son who dishonors his parents, who is put to death, if you look at the instructions, it requires that both the parents testify and that all the village testifies that this son was in open rebellion against his parents. These are things that are done out in the open, that is clear that there's no desire for a relationship. So I hope that kind of helps you understand that the whole concept of sin and the relationship and how that all works together. Remember, there's different types of sin, and it behooves us to actually go in and study the different types of sin so that we can better understand what is going on and why there's forgiveness for some sin but death for other sins. Okay, just like that guy picking up sticks on the Shabbat. If you read the text in the Hebrew, it doesn't just say he was picking up sticks. It's that he was doing it in a high-handed manner. He was doing it saying, God, I know your commandment, and I don't care. I'm going to pick up sticks regardless. And that destroys this beautiful relationship that's going on here. And that's what got people kicked out of the camp, was those times where they did not care about the relationship anymore. So, grant, what's really interesting with this patron-client relationship is that the granting of the petition is referred to in secular writings throughout the entire Greek Greco-Roman Empire as giving of grace, charis in the Greek. Isn't that interesting? That word grace had a huge secular, humanistic implication with it. When we hear the word grace today, we always, or almost always at least, think of grace in terms of theology. And yet in the first century world, grace was not necessarily a theological term. It was a well-understood concept in that world. And so this is how grace would work. Okay, grace was always said to be a free gift without obligation. These gifts were given without any sort of asking for anything in return. We see, for example, in the sacrifices were actually used to entreat God's grace. We can see this in Malachi 1, verse 9, where it says, let's start in verse 8. But when you present the blind as a sacrifice, is it not evil? And when you present the lame and the sick, is it not evil? Why not offer that to your governor? Would he be pleased with you? Or would he receive you kindly? Says Yahweh of hosts. But now, will you entreat God's favor that he may be gracious to us? Remember that word gracious is that the same word grace. In the Hebrew, it's from the root hanan. With such an offering on your part, will he receive anything from you kindly? So the whole idea of the sacrifices were a way, it was a petition for grace. Okay? And grace, while there's a petition for it, grace was said to be given freely. We can see in the book of Sirach, chapter 20, verse 13, says the wise make themselves beloved by only a few words, but the courtesies of the fools are wasted. A fool's gift will profit you nothing, for he looks for recompense sevenfold. Okay, so the fool is one who gives with the expectation of receiving a recompense for it. But the way that understood throughout society is when you give grace, it's completely without any sort of obligation attached to it, okay? And what this does is once the patron grants grace to the client, this initiates a circle, what is called a circle of grace relationship. And we'll talk about that a little bit more here, okay? So once this relationship is established, now there's a protocol for it. So the patron, he will call his client my friend, okay? But the client never calls the patron my friend in return. Why is this? Well, the patron is generally someone of a higher social status. And so he is honoring the patron or the client by calling him friend. I mean, think about this. If whoever your hero is, I won't name names because I don't want to offend anybody, but whoever your hero is, if he started calling you, hey, you're my friend, that would be a great honor to you, right? But in that society, someone of a lesser class trying to call someone of a higher class who's their patron, my friend, would be offensive to them, right? So what would they call them? They would call them sir, master, lord, savior. These were common titles for a patron. So we can see, for example, in John 15, verse 4, Yeshua says, you are my friends if you do as I commanded. And you see various times throughout the scripture, or throughout the New Testament, through the Gospels, that Yeshua refers to his disciples as my friends. Now let me ask you a question. Do the disciples ever refer to Yeshua as my friend? No, they do not. They refer to him as Lord or Master. Why? Because that's the honorable title given to your patron. You refer to them with respect, with honor. Just like when you address a judge, you're supposed to say, Your Honor, right? You don't just say, hey, judge, you're my buddy, you're my pal. Why don't you let me go? No, you address them in an honorable manner. It's about respect, okay? So the disciples always referred to Yeshua in a respectful manner. They did not call him, my friend Jesus. They called him Master, Messiah, Savior, titles that were of honor to him. So let's look at some of the cultural writings that help us to understand the relationship and the terminology and how the relationship, the mechanics of the relationship. This is from the writings of Aristotle, Rhetoric 2.7.1. He writes, grace, charis, may be defined as helpfulness towards someone in need, not in return for anything, nor for the advantage of the helper himself, but for that of the person being helped. So once again, this help, this grace was given with nothing in return. However, Sophocles writes, grace is always giving birth to favor. Now the word for grace is charis, and the word for favor is charin. It's the exact same word, it's just that the S ending denotes the subject, whereas karin is the direct object of the verbs. So don't get those two confused as separate words. They're the exact same word, just in with a different place in the sentence. So grace and favor are translated as the exact same word. We could literally say grace is always giving birth to grace, right? So grace given initiates grace as a response. That circle of grace, right? The patron gives grace, and the response is grace back from the clients. Okay? That's how the relationship works, is that the client was expected to respond with grace or with favor. Oftentimes, our theological terminology has brought the meaning of grace to mean something that it really never meant. We hear the term, maybe you've heard it, greasy grace, right? The concept of God just gives everything to you and you can do whatever you want. That is not the context of the word grace, charis, or even chanan. In the Hebrew, that is not the context, okay? The context of grace, it was always understood as it's freely given, but it is expected that you make a return. We're going to talk about that in just a minute when we return. Shalom, I'm Ryan White, and I really hope that you've been enjoying all the incredible content here on Hebraic Roots Network. There's a lot of people out there who are dying to receive the good news of Yeshua, to understand the scriptures from a proper context, from the Hebraic context of scriptures. And we love to be able to provide this information to everyone. But you know what? We need your support because, unfortunately, these things don't come for free. Help us provide the support for us to send this message out to the entire world. You can go onto HebraicRootsNetwork.com or give us a call at 1-800-657-9820. And there's several options. You can join the Tabernacle team, which is a $100 a month donation. Or you can use the Gideon's Army option, which is a $50 donation. Or at any time, you can choose to do a one-time donation of any amount. Any amount can help support, send the message out to the entire world so that we can all know and love our Master Yeshua. Welcome back. A virtuous person in that world was understood to always be seeking to reciprocate grace for grace. When they received grace, it was understood that anybody who was considered to be virtuous would always seek for a way to reciprocate, to respond to that grace in whatever way could help out the patron who gave that grace to them. And we'll talk about the ways that they would do that here in a little bit. Failure, however, to respond or to reciprocate was understood to destroy the gracious act. It was as if that gracious act had never even occurred, and it stops the entire relationship, okay? Failure to respond breaks that circle of grace, and there's no longer a relationship. It's that willful and rebellious attitude. You received something as a free gift, and you shunned it. You acted in spite of that. Think about this, right? We receive the gift of the grace of the Holy Spirit. And what is it, that the one sin that is unforgivable? To blaspheme the Holy Spirit, right? It is God's gift of grace. It's His biggest gift of grace to us right now is the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh that leads us into all these things. And if you blaspheme, remember that word blaspheme is to slander, to speak ill of, to shame the Holy Spirit, that is the one unforgivable sin. Why? Because that's destroying the relationship. You no longer have that circle of grace going on. You've broken down the relationship that was initiated with you by the Holy Spirit through Yahweh the Father, through Yeshua the Son as well. All right? Now, Cicero wrote, initiating grace is a matter of choice, right? Just because Israel cried out to God doesn't mean in Greek thinking that he had to respond, okay? Now, we understand that based on the what's called the hue and cry in the ancient Near East, that it was God is legally required to come to the assistance. Even Yeshua talked about this. You know, an unrighteous judge will respond. How much more the righteous creator of the universe will he respond? So, but in their understanding, in the first century, initiating grace was a matter of choice. However, gratitude was not an option for honorable people. So if you considered yourself to be honorable, you had to respond with gratitude. Receiving that grace puts a person under a debt of obligation. We see this in the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 14 through 19, where Paul writes, "For sin will have dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace? May it never be. Do not you know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, either to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves to sin, have become obedient in the heart to form the teaching with which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, become slaves of righteousness." And then listen to what he says. "I am speaking to you in human terms because of your natural limitations," right? He's explaining this concept of who you present yourself as a master to in the context of grace. If you present yourself as a slave, i.e. the client to the patron of righteousness, to God, then you're indebted. You owe God your obedience. You owe him your loyalty, okay? Patrons, even in that day and time, they would actually seek out clients that were known for their gratitude. Basically, it kind of became a credit rating, right? If you were known as a person who a patron would give something to and then you would not reciprocate, pretty soon no one would actually come and give you anything, right? They no longer wanted to be your patron because they knew that you were ungrateful. Now, we know that God, he even gives grace to the ungrateful, right? Obviously, God is above this sort of thing. That's why he came back and he rescued the lost sheep. He sent his own son for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Obviously, this was an ungrateful people. They had showed a disdain for Yahweh. They had not, we've got the northern kingdom who was spread out. They never tried to return to the land. We've got the southern kingdom, Judah, who was taken into the Babylonian exile, but only 5% of them actually returned to the land. If I remember correctly, they estimated something like 2 million Jews in the first century, but only 700,000 actually lived in the land of Judea, even. So even with a slow return, you still had more Jews living outside of the promised land that Yahweh had promised our forefathers. Look at today. Are we not in the same situation? The Israel became a nation. Did everyone flock there? No. They were not grateful for that response. But God still, even with that lack of gratitude, God still seeks them out and asks for them to return. We could see this. This is something kind of interesting principle in a very interesting document called the Didache, which Didache is the Greek term which means teaching. The full length of this document was called The Teaching of the 12 Disciples Through the Master Yeshua. And it was basically a first century training document for Gentiles who wanted to convert and come into the faith of Messiah Yeshua. And so if you ever read this document, I have a separate teaching on this, but it's really interesting because it's verified to have been written somewhere between 50 and 100 AD. And it shows a very Jewish culture, Jewish nature in it, in that these Gentiles, they had to go through a training process where they learned how to live a righteous lifestyle. And so in that document, in chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, we have this following statement. Give to everyone who asks help of you, and do not seek a return, because the Father wants his generosity to be shared with everyone. Blessed is everyone who gives according to this command, for a person goes without punishment. But watch out for those who receive things. If they receive things from need, there is no punishment. But if they receive things without need, then they shall have to explain why they acted in such a way, and they shall be questioned about it when put in prison, and they will not be released until every last penny is paid. So obviously they had people who were taking advantage of grace, of free offerings and stuff like that in the first century. And then this is what's key here. But remember, it has also been said that you should let your gift sweat into your hands until you know to whom it is given. Interesting. You let your gift sweat in your hands means you hang on to it until you know to whom it's being given to, right? Just kind of like Yeshua said, right? Don't feed your pearls to the pigs. Give to someone, if you want to paraphrase that, give to someone who's going to respond, not to you, but to God. Give to someone who's going to appreciate it as a gift from God and respond in appropriate way of giving back to God, of giving glory and honor and acknowledging that this is a gift from God. Okay, so let's go into this and let's talk about the client's proper response. The protocol was three specific things that were required for the patron or for the client to respond to his or her patron. number one, was publicly enhancing the fame and honor of the patron. Number two, is remaining loyal to the patron. Number three, is providing gifts and services to the patron whenever the opportunity would arise, and oftentimes with interest even. Okay, so let's go down and let's look at each one of these and break them down and see how these worked out and what this means to us, okay? So giving honor to the patron. We've talked a lot about this in the beginning of this series on honor and shame, okay? But here's a statement from the first century. A gift that one is ashamed to acknowledge openly in the hearing of all, one has no business accepting in the first place. Isn't that interesting? Didn't Yeshua say something like that? Let's go to Luke 12, verse 8, and see what Yeshua says. Yeshua says, "And I tell you, everyone who acknowledges me before others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge before the angels of God. But whoever denies me before others will be denied before the angels of God." So, if we want Yeshua to acknowledge us as his own, what are we required to do? We are required to publicly acknowledge Yeshua as our Master and our Savior. We have to publicly acknowledge him as our Messiah in order for him to acknowledge us before the Father. And there's other verses that also talk about that same concept. We have to publicly give honor to Yeshua in order for him to give honor to us before the Father. Other ways that this would be done: public sacrifices. We read in Malachi about how the sacrifices were something that initiated God's grace, and there were a way. Think about this. Think about the Hebrew term is the shelamim, which it would be translated as the peace offering or the well-being offering, terminology like that. What was the function of that offering? It was a way of it was used as a way of thanksgiving to God, giving thanks to God. Or if a vow was fulfilled, right? So you said, "God, you know, if I get this next promotion at work, I will offer to you a bull up as a shelamim, as a well-being offering." And what do you do? What, think about the whole situation with the tabernacle. You do have a fence, but anyone could come in there. It's the public meeting place, essentially. You're going to a public place and you're bringing in your well-being offering. And what do? You slaughter it, or the priest slaughters it. Some of the meat is burned on the altar. And then you take the rest of the meat, and some of it the priests eat, and some of it you eat. It's basically the shelamim, or the well-being or peace offering, was a barbecue with God. That serves the same function as our barbecues today. Why do we throw a barbecue today? Well, because we want to draw closer to our friends. Does anybody know, do you know what the word for sacrifice is in Hebrew? It's korban, which is from the root karav, which is a verb that means to draw near. When you brought that sacrifice, it was for the intent of drawing near to God, in order to publicly praise him and to have communion with God. Praising the name of God, we've talked about that. Worshiping, acknowledging the Master Yeshua, acknowledging Yahweh as your Master, the blessings, praises, all these things. When we go out and we sing songs in our congregation to God, what are we doing? We're publicly giving him honor. That is the appropriate response for the grace that he's given us. Now, that's not all of the response, but that's part of our response of gratitude, is to sing his praises in public, not just in your shower in your bathroom, but out in public where people can see and they realize that you have been blessed by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one true creator in the heavens That is what our mandate is to do. Part of our mandate is to render honor to Him, render praises to Him. When we do our works, what are they supposed to be for? They're supposed to give honor to Yahweh. Let's go back to that verse we read earlier. Matthew 5, verse 16. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory or honor to your Father in heaven. Even our works, even our Torah observance should be based on the concept of giving honor to our Father in heaven. Not so that people can go, wow, that Ryan guy, he really wears the tzitzit well. He keeps the feast, he keeps the Shabbat. No, that's not what it's about. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not about me. It's not even about you. It's about Him. We give honor to Him. When we do these things, let other people know, it's not me. It's Him. I just want to praise Him because of what He's given me. He is my patron. He's given me all these things, and this is my way of just saying thank you, Daddy. This is my way of reciprocating. Look at the Torah. Was the Torah given? Did God bring them out and say, now listen up, you guys. You guys have to keep the Torah, otherwise I won't take you out of Egypt. No, that's not what happened. He didn't come down to them while they were still slaves in Egypt and said, guys, once I see you guys all observe the Shabbat perfectly for 3 months in a row, I'll pull you guys out of here. Oh, and you guys better be keeping the feast too. That's not what He said. They cried out to Him. He responded, a complete act of grace. He pulled them out. He did one of the greatest things in history, rescuing them from the hands of the Egyptian bondage. And He pulls them out and He takes them to the wilderness, to Mount Sinai, to the marriage canopy, right? And they come out there and they say, what can we do now in response? And He goes, well, let me tell you. I'm your patron. Look at all these wonderful things I've done for you. And think about this. Think about how many of the commandments, or how many times you see in the Torah, God has done this for us. In fact, in Deuteronomy 6, right after the Shema. In fact, let's go there really fast. I want to go there and talk about this, okay? Because this is important. Let's go to Deuteronomy 6. We all know verse 4, Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad, right? Hear, O Yisrael, Yahweh is our God, Yahweh alone. And then you go a little bit further down, and it says, where is it where it talks about when? Here we go, verse 20. It says, when your son asks you in a time to come, saying, why do the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments mean, what does the Torah mean? What are the testimonies, the statutes, and the judgment mean, which Yahweh our God has commanded you? Are you supposed to say, well, God said to do it, so you must do it, son. Don't worry about why we do it, just do it. No, it says, when your son comes to ask you, Daddy, why do we keep the Torah? Why do we keep the judgments, the statutes, the testimonies? What does he say? He says, then you shall say to your son, we were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, and Yahweh brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Moreover, Yahweh showed us great and distressing signs and wonders before our eyes against Egypt, Pharaoh and all of his household. He brought us out from there in order to bring us in and to give us the land which he has sworn to our fathers. So Yahweh commanded us to observe these statutes, to fear Yahweh, our Elohim, for our own good, always, for our survival, as it is today. It will be righteousness for us if we carefully observe this commandment before Yahweh our God, just as he commanded us. That is the basis for how we're supposed to teach our children why we keep the Torah. It's not about just because God said so. It's a response to his grace. He gave us grace, bringing us out of Egypt. This is how we properly respond, is in a manner of thanking him. And by responding, what do? It's that circle of grace, okay? He gives to us, we respond, he gives to us. We respond, keeps on going on and on. If you want God to pour out his blessings, respond. Respond to him. That's where grace comes from, is from that relationship where there's reciprocity. There's equal give, and you give to me, I give to you. You give to me, I give to you. Not you give everything to me and I do what I want, God, because I'm saved by grace and I don't need to do any works. I can just do whatever I want. In fact, I'm going to do the opposite of what you say just to prove that my salvation doesn't come from works. No, our works are our means of reciprocating to God, of showing him that we're grateful for what he has done for us. They're not for our salvation. We're not saved by what we do. We're saved by a gift of God, just like Israel was saved from Egypt by a gift of complete grace. And yet if they wanted to continue on the relationship for God to actually bring them into the land and to drive out the enemies from before them, they had to respond. They had to honor him. Okay? Let's go to Psalms 116, 12 through 19. What shall I return to Yahweh for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of Yahweh. I will pay my vows to Yahweh in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of Yahweh is the death of his faithful ones. Yahweh, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds, and I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call upon the name of Yahweh. I will pay my vows to Yahweh in the presence of his people, in the courts of the house of Yahweh, which is the temple, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise Yahweh. You ever wonder why the temple had to be built in Jerusalem, why you couldn't just go sacrifice in your backyard? Because you had to be in the presence of his people. It was about rendering honor to him, which has to be done out in public. Public people. It's public praising. We can't be a believer only on Shabbat, only in hiding, and then the rest of the week go out and act like the world. We have to act like we are a believer. We have to be a believer, should I say, all the time. We have to publicly acknowledge him and show the whole world the level of his grace and the changes that it makes in our life. Let's go to Tobit 12, verse 6. Then Raphael called to the two of them privately and said, "Bless God and acknowledge him in the presence of all living for the good things which he has done. Bless and sing praise to his name. With fitting honor, declare to all people the deeds of God. Do not be slow to acknowledge him. It is good to conceal the secret of a king, but to acknowledge and reveal the works of God. With fitting honor to acknowledge him. Do good and evil will not overtake you." That's our context here. That's praising our king for what he's done. Publicly praise and acknowledge him. Let the whole world know that he has given us the gift of salvation. He has given us the gift of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. He has given us the gift of release of bondage from sin. Let everyone know that. That's our duty. Loyalty to the patron is the next role or responsibility of the client. So where do we see this? We see this, for example, in 1 John 2, verse 3 through 6. "And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for those of the whole world. By this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. The one who says, 'I have come to know him,' but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God has truly been perfected. By this we know that we are in him. The ones who say he abides in him ought himself walk in the same manner as he walked. Okay? So our loyalty is shown by walking in the same manner as Yeshua walked. Did Yeshua keep the feast? Yes, he did. Did Yeshua keep the Sabbath? Yes, he did. Did Yeshua eat kosher? Yes, he did. Did Yeshua take care of the poor? Yes, he did. Did Yeshua forgive the sinners? Yes, he did. Yeshua even forgave those who killed him. We are supposed to walk in the same manner to show loyalty to him. It's our response to live the way that he did. It's the faith of Yeshua that we're supposed to have. We're supposed to have that unswerving devotion to Yahweh the Father. That's what Yeshua had. That's what we are supposed to do. When we walk the way that he walked, we are supposed to live in perfect faith, in perfect loyalty to the Father. Because we know that it doesn't matter what happens. The world can beat us. The world can spit at us. The world can steal our things. The world can mock us and ridicule us. Sometimes I think that's even harder than being beaten, is to be mocked and ridiculed at work. The world can even crucify us. The most shameful way, a very painful way to die. And we have to know with perfect faith that Yahweh is faithful and true, and that he will justify those who have faith in Yeshua. Just like Yeshua had perfect faith that no matter what humanity had done to him, that the Father would be faithful to resurrect him from the dead, so too we must be acknowledging and faithful to the fact that it doesn't matter. You can chop off our heads, ISIS. You can display our corpses in the street. You can do all your things to us, but we serve a king who will bring us back. And one day it will be to our honor and to your shame. Keeping of faith. In fact, faith was used even outside of religious contexts. Keeping of faith was used in terms of both the patron and the client. By maintaining that relationship, that is the concept of biblical faith and of secular faith in that world, was being staying true to your patron. And what's interesting, though, is that you could actually have multiple patrons. Loyalty to your patron didn't necessarily mean you couldn't have another patron. The thing is that the patrons could not be rivals or enemies. So let's put this in the context of our faith. Can Yahweh be our patron and can Yeshua be our patron? Absolutely, because they're on the same side. Yahweh is the king of the universe. Yeshua is his son. He's the prince. In fact, if you read 1 Corinthians 15, it talks about that God the Father gives Yeshua the crown, the throne, and that Yeshua comes and has to put the earth into complete submission until everything is put in complete submission and death is destroyed. Then he turns the kingdom over to the Father so that the Father can be all in one. So we can serve Yeshua and we can serve Yahweh at the same time. You've got to study the concept of the ancient Near East of suzerain vassal treaties. You can have Yeshua is the vassal of the suzerain, Yahweh, but to us, he is our suzerain. They're one and the same, right? Now, can we serve Yahweh and Baal? Absolutely not, because they are enemies. You cannot have rivals, patrons. They have to be working together. That's how Yeshua can be our patron, but not some other god. Okay, so we're not polytheistic in that we worship Yeshua and worship Yahweh, because worshiping Yeshua is, in fact, worshiping Yahweh. In fact, Yeshua is something that was well known, that one patron could provide access to an even greater patron in that day. So they would be called either a broker or a mediator. Yeshua is our mediator to the greater patron, Yahweh the Father. So I pray that you're enjoying this. We're going to go ahead and finish up with part one, and we'll be back later on.